And I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. It's my first trip to Korea. It's a great honor. So I want to talk about some joint work. With Koras, who is here. So let me recall some famous theorem of Mumford. So let V be a small contractible neighborhood of a normal singularity, normal surface singularity. Normal, so such that phi 1 of V minus P is trivial. So punctured neighborhood has trivial fundamental group, then P is a smooth point. So this is a very famous theorem which has been very influential. And
but this neighborhood has to be sufficiently small, right?
Yeah, small. Small. And one can't be very very precise. So one can ask whether there is some global analog of this result. For example, you can ask a very naive question. Suppose V is a normal affine surface such that phi 1 of V minus singular locus is trivial. Is V smooth? So when I was a student, I asked this question, being very naive at that time. But I soon realized that this is too much to expect. One is, there is not much assumption, and one can easily find counterexamples. So what is lacking here, which is there, is the assumption of contractibility. And surprisingly, if you assume further that V is contractible, then the answer is yes. So this is the theorem. So theorem, suppose V is normal, affine.
Ramana, we can prove something assuming simple like right?
Yeah, yeah. But he assumes smooth. He assumes smooth. Suppose V is a normal affine surface which is topologically contractible. Then V is smooth. So this is the theorem. In some sense, it's somewhat satisfactory global analog of Mumford's theorem. So the proof of this theorem uses the theory of non-complete algebraic surfaces developed by Japanese mathematicians in an essential way. So I will say something about this theory. So before that, I must say that there are examples. So there exist examples. So there exist examples to show.
What's wrong with that cone over a projective curve?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. This is the thing. Such that y1 of v minus singular locus is trivial. Yeah, I'm sorry. Thanks. No, then this won't be, you know, pi1 will be some finite group. If you take cone over p1, pi1 will be some z mod n.
Okay. The cone over p1, the fundamental group is cyclic.
Yeah. So there exists.
The cone over embedding of p1, then it's smooth. If it's a cone over embedding of p1, then it's smooth.
Yeah.
Okay.
So there is examples to show that contractibility is necessary. So we have several examples. I'll just mention one or two. So there exists normal affine surface V such that pi1 of V minus singular locus is trivial. Euler characteristic of V is 3. So in particular, V cannot be contractible, and V has an E8 singularity. So this is the famous UFD, two-dimensional UFD. So this is one. And secondly, there is another example which is also interesting. There exists V as above, such that pi1 of V minus singular locus V is trivial. Class group. So this is the divisor class group of V. Is trivial. H2 VZ is free abelian. Of rank 2. Kappa bar of V tilde is minus infinity. So here kappa bar is the resolution of singularities of V. I will define kappa bar very quickly later on. So this is for those who know logarithmic quadratic dimension of the resolution of singularity. This is called V tilde. Suppose it is, so this is minus infinity. And so of course it has, so V has bad, let me just say bad singularities. So bad means when I resolve, the exceptional locus is not even a tree of rational curves. So okay, so there are such examples. If I have time, I will indicate at least one, which is somewhat interesting. V is a normal affine surface. So V tilde is a resolution of singularities. Because you know, one can define kappa bar only for smooth varieties.
So with exceptional curves.
Yeah. So okay. So let me begin with some preliminaries.
The class divisor class group is zero means that H2, the second homology of V minus singular locus is zero.
No, but this is free abelian of rank 2. Yeah, I mean this is not so easy. Yeah, unless the geometric genus is 0, things are somewhat bad, I think. geometric genus has to be 0 for what you are saying to be true. So I am not saying. So now let me begin with some preliminaries. So let me quickly define kappa bar for those of you who don't know. So this is called logarithmic coder dimension. So we assume that let y be a smooth algebraic surface, and I will take only varieties defined over complex numbers because I want to use topology very freely. So embed smooth, of course, irreducible. So let y contained in x be a smooth compactification. Such that D, which is x minus y, is a simple normal crossing divisor. So then you take n times k of x plus D. Look at this linear system and see the growth of this linear system as n goes to infinity. So then you define the kappa bar according to the growth of this. So we say that kappa bar is minus infinity if this linear system is 0 for all n bigger equals 1. So only 0 section equal to 0 if dimension of this is bounded function of n equal to 1 if this dimension grows linearly with n, and kappa bar is 2 if the dimension grows quadratically as a function of n. I will not write it here because so 2 just means this dimension grows quadratically as a function of n. So this is roughly the, now for each of these classes there is a very rich theory developed by Japanese mathematicians, and we have to use this very special information for each class to prove our theorem. So before beginning with that, let me do some simple observations. So now I am assuming now my V is like this, topologically contractible and smooth locus is simply connected. So let V tilde to V be a resolution of singularities. And V tilde contained in V, a nice compactification. V bar. So nice means that V bar is smooth and the divisor at infinity is simple normal crossing. Okay. So let E be the exceptional divisor after resolving the singularities, and D equal to V bar minus V tilde. So this is the divisor at infinity, which is simple normal crossing, and E is the exception. So now, using the fact that our surface is contractible and fundamental group of the smooth locus is trivial, using standard techniques like Mayer-Vittori sequence, Poincaré duality, relative cohomology, etc., one proves. So using using the assumptions, we prove the following. So one is E is a disjoint union of trees of P1s. So that means for every singular point, the exceptional divisor is a tree of P1s. Similarly, D. Similarly, D is a tree of P1s. So this is something nice. You know, it's nice to deal with trees of rational curves instead of some general curves. Secondly, basically the contractibility of V says that the cohomology or homology of the V bar.
That the D is big and disconnected.
Yes. So the fact that V is contractible roughly, and this means, at least you know, it's easy to believe that all the cohomology of V bar will be generated by the irreducible curves in E and D. It is kind of easy to believe. So H2 of V bar Z is freely generated by the irreducible components of E union D.
If I take a cone over something non-rational, the exceptional divisor won't be rational.
No, but I'm assuming this.
Okay, so this is also needed to show.
Yeah, yeah. Using the assumptions, you know.
Yeah, but I thought you only said it's using contractibility.
Okay. No, using the assumptions.
Okay.
There is an S.
I mean, actually, for your remark, it's sufficient that the homology is trivial. Okay, you apply Meyerbeer's orders to the homology.
Yeah, correct. Okay, so this irreducible curves here generate this freely, and this implies, so hence the intersection form on E and D is unimodular. It's easy to prove that because this is freely generated by this, the geometric genus of V bar is trivial because by using simple Hodge theory. So then the H2 VZ, you know, we know that H2 V bar is this intersection form is unimodular, and so that forces that each connected component here has unimodular intersection form. So that shows that already the singular points have very strong restrictions. The exceptional divisor for every singular point has unimodular intersection form. So eventually I will prove that right now I will just say that if the singular points are rational, then each singular point is E at time. Because if you have rational singularity whose intersection form is unimodular, then there is only one possibility, namely E at. So once one has proved that the singularities are rational, this will follow. So this will we will prove this using the theory of open algebraic surfaces later on. For each class we apply the special knowledge, and so these are easy observations just from the assumptions. So far I have not used the theory of Kappa bar. I think it is it's not a tree of p1s. Yeah. So now it is time to start using the rich theory of logarithmic quadratic dimension. So generally the I will start with the hardest case. Assume that Kappa bar of V minus singular locus is 2. Generally this is very hard to deal with because this is mostly the general type case, but here there are some very nice arguments, somewhat deep but conceptually at least nice. So in this case,
I mean, you can assume that logarithmic, I think it's minus infinity or.
No, anything can happen at this stage. We don't know. we have to treat each case carefully.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think I proved some generalization of Mantel's theorem.
Okay.
Years ago.
I see.
That would be useful.
Okay. So we start with this case. So in this case, there is Miyaoka-Yau type inequality, Yau type inequality due to Kobayashi. Nakamura and Sakai. Now the statement of this involves many terms. I cannot explain the various notions of minimality and so on in the statement. So let me just state the result, just not to look very mysterious. So the result is it's like this: 0 less than. This is Kappa bar of topological of V bar C 0 plus summation P in Q prime 1 over mod G P minus 1. Okay, this is the inequality of Kobayashi, which it's a very deep result actually. And most of the results about this case, you know, we have many papers, Koras, myself, and so in all the paper, this inequality plays a very crucial role. So there are this term is somewhat difficult to explain, but I will just say that where V bar C, gamma bar C is the log minimal model of V bar gamma, where gamma equal to E union D. So you start with this pair, and there is a notion, various notions of minimality in the theory of open algebraic surfaces. So there is something called log minimal pair, which is obtained from this pair by successively removing some curves and so on, and it may finally introduce some singularities. So, and Kappa bar, so this, there is something I can say about this first term, Kappa of V bar C 0 equal to
what is V C 0?
Yeah, VC0. Yeah. I think it is probably this one. You know, finally I get some this log minimal pair. So I take the complement. This is so the Euler characteristic of this is 1 minus t, where t equal to number of non-quotient singularities. So this is the first part, and here these are the quotient singularities. So q prime equal to quotient singularities. In V bar C here. So we have separated the term. This here we are sort of taking care of quotient singularities which are not singularities which are not quotient type, and here we have quotient type singularities, and this is the local fundamental group at that singularity. For every quotient singularity, fundamental group is finite. So this is the inequality of Kobayashi, and this has very important consequences.
Zero is V minus the singular locus, which is simply connected. So the first Betti number is zero.
No, this is C. You know, this is not V. This is not V. V was, you know, V minus singular locus was simply connected. But I have gone to some different open subset of that.
But you removed E and
T. No, this is also, you know, this is V bar C and gamma bar C. The original thing is V bar gamma.
That's another one.
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry.
You have to keep removing some very special curves.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay. So I just stated it so that you know you can see at least something about the inequality. In fact, the proof of this due to Kobayashi is differential geometric, and recently I think Langer has proved analogous result even when kappa bar is 1. So in some other context, in Kora's lecture, he will need even the Langer generalization of this even when kappa bar is 1. So Langer's proof is more geometric. Okay, so this inequality has some very important consequences. So as a consequence we see that V has at most one singular point, and it has type E at. So this is a consequence of this inequality by carefully analyzing all the terms and how the minimal model is obtained and so on. What curves you have to remove to get, etc. So I cannot go into the proof how this follows from that. But this is a very, very important thing which Kora's will also need later. So now we have the following picture. Now, so this is the V tilde. We have only one singularity, so we have some exceptional divisor here. So which is sort of, I'm not drawing the correct picture for E8 here, just to indicate. And then here is some D, you know, some we have D. This is the picture. Now we know that since the intersection form on D is unimodular. This was part of the preliminaries. If you take a tubular neighborhood, the boundary of a tubular neighborhood n of d has is a homology three sphere. So which means if I take, you know, you can draw some kind of boundary here. So boundary will be four dimensional, real four dimensional manifold. The neighborhood will be four dimensional, boundary will be three dimensional manifold, and the boundary has the property that H1 of so such a three manifold is called a homology three sphere. So here is our boundary of N. Now if I take a tubular neighborhood here, similarly the boundary of this is this called Poincaré three sphere. So we have this nice picture. Here is a Poincaré three sphere, here is some another homology three sphere, and there is this part is simply connected. So there is a, you can imagine that this three manifold and this three manifold, in between you have something simply connected by assumption here. So this is what is called as a simply connected cobordism between this and this boundary and that boundary. So now we come to another deep result. So we get a simply connected cobordism between P and a homology three sphere. We don't know how this homology three sphere looks, but you can imagine this in between thing is a four manifold which has two boundary components. One of them is Poincaré three sphere, and this is some other homology three sphere. But such a thing cannot happen. So Taubes proved using gauge theory that this cannot happen. So this is somewhat
cannot happen unless it can happen if P is P.
No, but it won't be simply connected still. See, you are thinking of some kind of product or something, some kind of product, but product won't be simply connected. So even that is not allowed. So this is the proof that finally you can't have a singularity. So hence yet cannot occur. So this is in some sense the deepest part of the proof, because kappa over 2 is always very hard to deal with, but fortunately we have these wonderful theorems. So this observation we learned from this was observed by Kalimann and Savelier. Now this kind of argument is simply connected cobordism, etc. It's in a paper of Kalimann and Savelier. So it was somewhat unsatisfactory that you have to use these deep theorems. So after some time, three of us, four of us, Koras, Mianesh, Russell and myself, we proved this result, so which will be the part of Koras' lecture set. So remark. We can avoid Taubes' work. So this will be the topic of Marius' lecture. So I don't want to say more, but one can give a completely algebraic geometric proof of something even stronger, that will imply that this E8K type of singularity cannot occur. So that will be in the afternoon today. So at least we have a, let's say, more elementary proof in some sense. So having proved the kappa bar 2, now I will go to the easier cases when kappa bar is 0, 1, minus infinity. So now let me assume that kappa bar of V minus singular locus is 1. This is the next, in some sense, this is the simplest case to deal with.
I mean, can we use small confidence theorem?
Where?
Putting together the local fundamental groups.
Yes.
And the fact that the intersection is trivial.
No, but you know, they are, it's not so simple, I think. It's not so simple. No, this.
But does it really depend on having a smooth manifold?
Sorry? I'm sorry?
But we're just trying to make a proof using only homotopy theory.
Okay.
But for manifolds, we know the smooth structure is important. So you're referring to this result of power, which is, of course, is engaged for.
Yeah.
So using smooth structure.
Yeah.
So is the result not true in the homotopy case? Well, maybe that's what the next
one. I'm not sure. I think, because all the, you know, the both the proofs, this proof and our proof later on, use algebraic geometry crucially. So I have no idea about the topological things. So let me go to this case. So in this case, so by result of automata, there exists a C star vibration, say V minus singular locus to some curve. So C star vibration means general fiber system, say general fiber C star. It can have singular fibers, but general fiber is C star. This is a standard result due to automata. So we analyze the singular fibers. So easy case is, so case 1, so suppose phi extends to a C star vibration on whole of V. A priori, we don't know what is going to happen when you try to extend. But suppose it extends as a C star vibration again. So then the singular points, are contained in fibers. So there will be some singular fibers, because V is, you know, a priori V is singular. So the singular points will lie in certain fibers. Then one knows completely, you know, whenever you have a C star vibration on a normal affine surface, what kind of singularities can occur, what kind of singular fibers occur. So Mianishi proved that all the singular points in this case are either cyclic or dihedral. So this is some analysis of singular fibers when you have C star vibration on a normal affine surface. But one knows that if you take any cyclic quotient singularity or dihedral singularity, the intersection form is not unimodular. The intersection form is not unimodular. because these are obviously rational singularities, and only rational singularity, surface singularity, whose intersection form is unimodular is E8. So again E8 is appearing here. So that shows that in this case the result is proved. So now we go to the case when case 2, phi does not extend. A vibration on V. So that means there is some kind of base point when you try to extend. So let me draw a picture. So there is some base point and you have all these. When I take the closures of the fibers of this map, they will all pass through some point. So I will just draw some kind of picture and this will be one of the singular points. We are not going to analyze how the singular point looks, but some do something different, some kind of indirect method. So, but one can show that again using contractibility, etc., all the singular fibers are irreducible. All the singular fibers of phi, this original map phi, they are irreducible, and C stars. And
I don't understand why. You said before that the general fiber is C star.
Yeah, but basically, you know, because of it's a kind of unique factorization domain. So the nothing, no contribution can come from V minus singular points. So if there is, roughly speaking, if there is some reducible fiber, the class group won't be trivial. So that shows that everything has to be irreducible, and they are actually and a singular fiber is a multiple C star. So general fiber is a reduced C star and special fiber is a multiple C star. That is the only thing that can happen using contractibility. So now we analyze how many singular fiber, multiple fibers are there. So if phi has at most two multiple fibers, so let me draw some two multiple fibers here, right? Then one can show that, so then look at the complement. So V minus these two singular fibers is just C star cross C star. You can imagine we have only two singular fibers which are multiple. All others are C star. Base will be, one can show B is P1. In this case, I call the base to be B. But whenever there is a base point, one can show that the base has to be complete. So it will be P1. From P1, I am removing these two points corresponding. So I get base to be C star. Every fiber is C star. So it is C star cross C star. But this has kappa bar of C star cross C star. This is 0 and this is embedded in our surface. So C star cross C star is contained in V minus singular points. This implies that kappa bar of V minus singular points is also less than or equal to 0, because you have an open subset whose kappa bar is 0. So the bigger thing also has kappa bar left. But our assumption was that kappa bar of V minus singular locus was 1. So this is the case when at most two multiple fibers occur. So now let's consider the case where there are three or more. So case 2, suppose at least 3 multiple fibers. Sorry?
You take the base chain,
yeah, yeah.
And this could produce simple.
Exactly, chain. Exactly, correct, correct, yes. Suppose at least 3 multiple fibers occur. So, in that picture, now we will have, let's say, 3 multiple fibers, at least. Then, we can take a base change of base ramified at 3 or those more points with prescribed multiplicities. This is the famous theorem, it was Fenchel's conjecture, I think, proved by Nielsen and Bungard and Hawks, I think. So you can take a ramified cover of the base at given points with prescribed ramification and pull back the vibration. Then what you get will be a covering of this, topological covering of V minus singular locus. So we get a topological covering of V minus singular locus by taking a suitable branch cover. Of the base. But our assumption is that V minus singular locus is simply connected. So you cannot have 3 or more multiple fibers. So that completes the proof when cup of bar is 1. Now I will have to hurry somewhat to talk about other cases. Sorry?
This covering you are taking could be the trivial covering, so you...
No, no, it won't be trivial because the degree of the map will be more than...
Sorry, don't understand. Is ramified?
At 3 or more points.
The more ramified covering of the base is connected.
Yeah, yeah.
And the fibers are connected, so...
I missed the response.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So now we go to the case when the power of V minus singular locus is 0. So here some work of Fujita is very crucial. So Fujita described the boundary. In this case, whenever kappa bar of some smooth algebraic surface is trivial, when you compactify, Fujita's work describes the boundary D very precisely. Now there is some technical point here about Zariski-Fujita decomposition. So Zariski's decomposition was generalized by Fujita for K plus D. There is something called Zariski-Fujita decomposition, P plus N, where P is the nef part, N is the negative definite part, and P is orthogonal to every irreducible component here. So P dot every irreducible component here. So there is such a decomposition. So by a very careful analysis of this decomposition, Fujita has described the boundary of D very precisely. Now I will not go into, because there are some small technical points. But the crucial thing is that the D cannot be unimodular. If we use Fujita's description of the boundary, you can see that none of those cases is unimodular. But we know in our case, D is the intersection form on D is unimodular. So this is conceptually very a very brief description of this case. But there are some points I'm sort of showing them under the rug, I think. So now we'll go to kappa bar minus infinity. So this is the final case. Even this case is surprisingly not so easy. There are some somewhat deep results of Mianishi and Sonoda involved. So this, in this case, there are two cases again. So whenever, you know, some algebraic surface has kappa bar minus infinity, the nicest thing that can happen is that there is some open subset which is product of a smooth curve cross A1. This is the nicest thing that can happen, but it does not always happen, unfortunately. So case 1, B minus singular locus has an A1 fibration. So this is generally a favorable case, because whenever you have a A1 fibration and V is affine, so this extends to V as an A1 fibration. So we don't have the trouble like the C star case, because now V is affine. If V minus singular finitely many points has A1 fibration, there is no difficulty extending this to V as an A1 fibration. This is easy. So affineness of V is crucial. So then this implies the singular points of V are cyclic quotient. So Mianishi proved that whenever you have a normal affine surface which has an A1 fibration, then all the singular points are at most cyclic quotient singularity. But cyclic quotient singularity does not have unimodular intersection form. So the singular points, the intersection form on them is not unimodular. So this case also cannot occur. So now we go to the case where there is no case 1, V minus singular locus has no A1 fibration. This is a very hard case in general. Whenever you, then what to do? So fortunately, there is a deep result due to Mianishi and Sonoda result. I will not describe precisely what that result is, but it implies that V is isomorphic to C2 mod binary icosahedral 2. This is the famous group which gives the E8 singularity. So this is this just nothing but, you know, the
quotient
by bin. So this is just this famous affine surface. So this surface is just this global affine surface. So one can prove that in this case V has to be this. This is a deep result due to Mianishi Sonoda. But then you check that in this case, if you remove the singular point, it is not simply connected. After removing the singular point, the fundamental group will be this binary icosahedral group, which has order 120. So even this case cannot occur. So this sort of conceptual proof.
Well, it's proved by unimodularity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, unimodularity is there. You see, this group is intersection form is unimodular. Yeah. But fundamental group of the smooth locus is not trivial here. If you take this surface, remove the singularity,
yes,
the fundamental group is precisely this. Yes. So this is so this completes the proof of a fine Mumford theorem. So let me quickly describe an example. So there exists a smooth projective rational surface. X with an elliptic vibration. X to P1 and it has exactly two singular fibers of type 2 and 2 star. So let me, I will just say what these fibers are. So 2 just means it's a rational curve with just one ordinary cusp of multiplicity 2. And 2 star is you take the E8 singularity and add one more curve, that is 2 star. And there is a section, and let me draw the E8 plus one more curve. So that curve, so there is a section here with self intersection minus 1. There is a curve from that fiber 2 star which meets that, and then you have E8 singularity 1, 2, 3, 4. So this part is the E8. And E8 plus one curve which meets the section, this is the 2 star. And then the other fiber is type 2, which is just a rational curve. So now you take a general fiber, so call this general fiber, let us say F infinity. This is a general elliptic curve and call this as S. So we have such a thing which, you know, is well known that such a thing exists. Now what you do is you contract this E8 to a singularity. So this you will get some picture like this. So after I contract this, I will get E8 singularity here. So here is F infinity, this is S, and call this surface as, let us say, V or V bar something. This is the normal projective surface with this kind of elliptic vibration with some singularity. Now you take V equal to V bar minus S union F infinity. If you take this, then this has the property, so remove one general fiber and the section, then it has E8 singularity. So one has pi 1 of V minus singular locus is trivial, but I think all the characteristic of V is 3. It is very easy to calculate all characteristic once you have this picture. So this V cannot be contractible. This is a simple example. So do I have 2 minutes?
Or? Yes, you still have 2 minutes.
Okay, so I can state a corollary of our main theorem, and I think Mariusz will speak more about it. No, this is the standard action, but
so this is just
EA. Yeah, standard action. I mean, the theorem of Mihanishir. No, the Mihanishir Sonoda theorem says that the quotient is that surface is the standard quotient of C2. There is no. Corollary. So this corollary is a very striking result about automorphism groups of so called Z homology planes. So let V be a smooth Z homology plane with kappa bar . So what is the Z homology plane? So this again, this will be defined later by Akoras. So this just means HI of VZ is 0 for I positive. So these examples are, at least in affine algebraic geometry, these surfaces are rather important. So we have such a surface and assume that kappa bar is 2. Again, this is the hard case. So then we have the following consequence. Then V has at most one singular point P Then the ought V is a finite cyclic group . So if assume that automorphism group is non-trivial, of course it can be trivial, but if it is non-trivial, it is a finite cyclic group with at most with a unique fixed point. Let us say P such that G acts freely outside P. That means for points outside P, there is no non-trivial isotropy, the action is free, so that one can take the quotient. So then the quotient V mod G is a Z homology singular surface with a unique singular point. So if V is not only Z homology, but suppose V is contractible, then this quotient is also contractible and it has only one singular point, and that singular point will be a finite cyclic group. So this is a big theorem about which Mariosz will speak later today. So this is a consequence of our affine Mumford theorem. Basically what you do is you analyze the map V to V mod G, analyze the ramification of this. Yeah.
Why the automorphism is a finite cyclic group?
This is the corollary.
Yeah, why?
No, it will take me too much time, I think.
Oh, okay.
I think maybe Koras will say more about this after his lecture, there is time. So you have to analyze the map and the ramification of this map, how many fixed points are there, isotropies, you know. It's not difficult. Once you have the theorem, the main theorem which Koras will talk about is that whenever you have such a surface, singular surface, which is a Z homology plane with kappa bar 2, it has at most one singular point, which is cyclic quotient. This is the main theorem which is subject of his talk. So I don't want to steal his thunder.
But, there is precisely a unique fixed point, or at most a unique fixed point?
There will be always a fixed point. See, because once you have a Z homology plane, by Smith theory, it has to have some fixed point.
Okay.
Thank you. So, thank you.